Richard.
So I'm going to be talking about narrative mediation and using metaphors. Just out of curiosity, anybody ever heard of narrative mediation? All right, okay. So I did a promo on you before, so I'm going to leave that out this time. I'm making the argument that metaphor mediation techniques would be really useful for people who do narrative mediation, because narrative and mediation and metaphor go together like peanut butter and jelly. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about narratives and metaphors and narrative mediation and metaphor mediation, and then I'm going to talk about why I think they go together. So it's always useful to start with a definition. What is a metaphor? A metaphor is a way to explain something you don't understand so well or that isn't so familiar by reference to something that you do know well or is familiar. And metaphors are whole, visual, nonverbal, and symbolic. So they get at all kinds of unconscious stuff. Using metaphors and working with the metaphors that the parties are using can reveal a lot that they can't articulate verbally. So an example is, my love is like a red rose. What does that tell us about this person's love? We could guess that they think their love is perfect, blooming, beautiful, maybe fragile, maybe temporary. Looking at how the implications of the metaphors people use can tell you a lot about what's going on. Metaphors reveal unconscious values and beliefs. Narratives are the stories people tell about the situations that they're in that help you see how they consciously make sense of things. So in my worldview research, I put them both together. Turns out if you can get access to and understand the way people consciously frame things, as well as indicators of their unconscious values, you can figure out a lot about what's going on. Just a little bit more about metaphors. That whole thing of using something more familiar and less familiar, they tend to talk about as the source domain and the target domain. And so, right, if you're talking to a little kid and they say, what is the moon? You can say, well, it's like a big lamp in the sky, right? So the source is the lamp and the target is the moon. And the metaphor is the bridge between the unknown and the known. And I'm taking a bunch of this from Thomas Smith, who's the guy that's done the best work in mediation using metaphors. Narratives are how we make and unmake conflicts. I love this quote from Weed. Think of someone you dislike and the story of what he did to you leaps to mind. We cannot hate without a tale to tell. And Michael White, who's the guy that came up with narrative therapy, which is how they developed narrative mediation, said we enter into stories, we are entered into stories by others, and we live our lives through stories. So what that means is, if we can help people change the stories they tell about the conflicts they're in and the metaphors they use, we can touch something profound and symbolic. This PowerPoint does not contain this story. I'm just putting it out there to make an explicit connection to the international arena. Winslet and Monk are the guys who came up with narrative mediation. Monk was actually asked to work with rebel generals who were preparing to negotiate in the democratic transition of Myanmar. And during that time, a friend of mine was working with him. We did a presentation on narrative mediation. She brought him in because the rebel generals were stuck in their narratives of who they were in a way that impeded their ability to negotiate in the new situation. So like that's a really short story, and it's like not my story to tell, so I don't want to get a lot into that. But I do want to let you know this stuff is being used on the international arena, and it makes sense. Who controls the narrative matters. It shuts down what we think of as possible. It opens up other avenues. So intervention into narrative can be powerful. This is just a real quick summary of some of the big thinking about narratives and how they work in mediations. Any of you who have been mediators know that the classic scenario is two parties come in, whoever you talk to first says, this is really simple. I am good, wise, and kind. They are evil, satanic, and terrible, right? We tend to tell very rigid narratives about the other person that are essentializing, i.e., we say they are essentially bad, and we focus only on what went wrong, and our narratives frame the situation as stuck and hopeless in a very defensive way. So there are lots of things we do when we tell stories about conflicts that keep us stuck. Cobb says that means that as a mediator, our job is to destabilize these rigid narratives, help people find some cracks in their stories that can bring in some light. And Monk and Winsley say that we've got to help the parties develop counter stories, alternatives to the dominant conflict narrative, which can support positive outcomes. So our job is, right, they come in with these rigid stories, we help them start to destabilize them a little bit, they're trying to begin to create a co-joint narrative that they can both exist in. It's fragile. It's easy for that to fall apart and go back to we hate each other. Our job is to help support and strengthen that new story so it becomes strong enough for them to hold real power after they leave the mediation and they can live into that new story. Some other stuff you should know about metaphors is that they carry baggage. So the understanding from the source concept limits your ability to wrap your head around the target. And let me give you an example. This is from the Northern Forest Land Council dialogue analysis by my friend Jane Doherty, who did brilliant work. Early on, the Forest Service in this country had metaphors for their job, which included forest is a wilderness, and the forest is a mine from which resources are extracted. Gifford Pinchot, at the end of the 19th century, introduced the metaphor of the forest as a farm. Well, guess what? That metaphor carried baggage. There are a whole lot of things wrapped up in our idea of farming, including that some trees are the crop, and some trees are the weeds. And this stuff plays itself out in reality. Thank you. Instead of seeing each metaphor as one possible way to explain objects and relationships, those who accepted the metaphor believed that the stories related to the metaphor described the real world. Guess what? If you see the forest as a farm, you do this, a world full of white pine. If you see the forest as an ecosystem, you do this. The metaphors and the narratives that people use have enormous power. And our ability to intervene in those and help people rethink them can have enormous power too. I've only got a minute left, so I'm gonna kind of zoom ahead here. Winsley and Monk do really interesting work that I think is really pushing the boundaries of mediation because they intervene directly in structural power, something that we rarely have the tools to do. And this is a great example. They say we have found it useful for the mediator to help the person who's captured by exaggerated entitlement to imagine that he is someone who, in his own better judgment, would not want to abuse or hurt another person, right? So this is them working with this couple, one of whom has very strong patriarchal ideas about their power over their partner. And this is the questions that the mediators ask to try and break up that rigid narrative, so that the man starts to see his role in a little bit more complexity. Do you want a marriage within which you can respect each other? How important is it for you to have a marriage based on genuine respect and trust? If Mary were doing as she's told, would she be more likely to give out of love and desire or out of duty? So I'm going to there, showing you a little bit about narratives and metaphors and why I think they go together.